to the floor, which we call is horizontal plane because it's the floor. And if you look at your XYZ, when I say vertical plane, out of X, Y, and Z, what is the axis that would represent your vertical plane?
Y
Everyone should say, which one?
The Y axis.
Y, very good. Okay, so Y represents your vertical plane along with, because you need to have two axes, right? You need to have one more, and that is your projection line. So the projection line is a mathematical term or maybe a technical term, but that behaves as if you're, if you have an extra axis for the vertical plane. So the vertical plane consists of your Y and your projection line. It's really important that you have to account for those two. Then if I bring my force acting in space down onto the floor as its image on the projection line, what would constitute your horizontal plane? What would constitute as your floor? Lewis?
X-axis.
X and what else is in the horizontal plane? You need two.
Z.
Z.
Very good. So your horizontal plane is called XZ plane. So let me write that here. So your vertical. And if you read your textbook, I think they will try to explain it to you, but they don't exactly use these terms like projection line or the image. That's my problem with the book on this. So the vertical plane, not plane, is always your Y axis and the projection line. And I don't think your textbook, as far as I know, uses the term projection anywhere. Okay, but that's what will give you the vertical plane always. Horizontal plane, and that one is always the same too, consists of your XZ plane. Okay. So if we were going to take our force, and this time it's acting in space, and I ask you to carry a force resolution, that means you're going to have to resolve your force into X component, Y component, and finally your Z component. So in 3D, you need to have three rectangular components, okay? And don't worry, I'm going to go through this step by step, and we're going to see example problems, homework problems. So if you don't catch everything right now, do not panic. We got more than enough time to figure this out. Now, the, one of the first things that you have to notice is the projection line. And from now on, I will always label it, as Dylene saw earlier, I will label it as a projection line so that you do recognize it and that you do see it as differently from your XYZ axis. Okay, so there will be no confusion. Now, if you're looking at your textbook, and I highly recommend that you do, because they use experts when it comes to illustrations, and they will actually draw like shadow plane, so you guys can see it better, okay? Now, the other two things that I want you guys to notice, and this is the key takeaway. You're always gonna be given, in addition to the projection line, at least two angles, at least two, and you need to have these two. Without them, you cannot carry out the force resolution. One of them has to be an angle in the vertical plane. One angle has to be given in the vertical plane, and there is, has to be another angle given in the horizontal plane. So one angle got to be given in the vertical plane and another given in the horizontal plane. Without them, you cannot do force resolution. So if you're given two angles and a projection line, I always tell my students, use method one for force resolution. If you're not given these two angles and the projection line, skip method one and use method two. And we will talk about method two in the next class. But so far, are you guys doing okay? Are you guys able to follow these notes?
Yep.
Yes.
Okay, good. We have a lot to go over here. And this is our review. You've seen something just like this in your 2D. So given the original force, again, bold means magnitude, right? I mean, sorry, vector. So if you're writing this in your notes, you're gonna have to write it like this. vectors, right? Okay. And you're going to take individual vector components, f sub x, f sub y, and f sub c, and we're going to find the respective scalar components, right? So you have these nodes from before, but what is new here is a z component and your unit vector right on the z-axis. So again, your unit vectors are I, j, and k along the axes x, y, and z respectively. And any unit vector, its magnitude is always going to be one, okay? So this is not really new here. Oh, Bobby, you're writing these? Okay. I posted these notes, by the way, but if you don't see them, please let me know, okay? But again, f sub x, f sub y, and f sub c, these are the ones that we need to find. Find them. That is our force resolution. And before we do anything, equilibrium or finding the resultant, right? We have to be able to resolve them into rectangular components. So I kept saying two methods, right? So let's take a look at the two methods. I'm calling them two methods. Your textbook doesn't give them names, okay? They just expect you to know, given the information on what method to use. So for method one, that's the first one that we're gonna talk about for force resolution. You have to have the magnitude of the force and you have to have two angles, one in the vertical plane and horizontal plane. And I forgot to mention one more here. What else do you have to have? Your projection line. We need to have that. Why did I forget to write that? You need to have a projection line for each force. And I won't worry about method two, but for method two, we're gonna be using a different method, having the magnitude of the force and any two points on the line of action. So again, this term line of action comes back. Okay, so let's take a look at, I got 3 minutes here, but let's take a look at your method one before I let you guys go. And when we come back, today's Wednesday, so I won't see you for another 5 days. Okay, when we come back on Monday, we'll get into example problems to show you, because just by looking at the steps, they don't really mean anything, right? But let me just summarize the method one just for you, okay? There are two steps involved. Again, very systematic. So once you do a couple of these problems, the steps should stick with you. They're very, very systematic and very logical. Step one. We're going to take our applied force in space and first resolve it in the vertical plane. And again, what is a vertical plane? Your y-axis and your projection line. Okay, then we're going to find two component forces. First being one of your rectangular components of F sub Y. And here is a new force that you have never seen before, but you're going to see this only in method one. We're calling this F sub H. That is the force on the projection line. And why the letter H? Your textbook uses the letter H to represent horizontal plane, but do not get confused with this H and the two component forces in your X and Z. Okay, so F sub H will always, always be on the projection line. And this value always has to be positive because your projection line does not have positive or negative. Okay, it's just an image on the floor. Step two, we're going to now take F sub H, the image of the force on the floor in the horizontal plane, and we're going to resolve that into X and Z components. This is your XZ plane. And therefore, we're going to find F sub X and F sub C. So we got three rectangular components, F sub X, F sub Y, and F sub C. But first we're gonna find F sub Y in the vertical plane, and then in the horizontal plane, we're gonna find f sub x and f sub c. I'm gonna have to stop here because it's 12:15. I wish if I can go longer, but I know you guys have other things to do. So when we come back on Monday, we're gonna do an example, and I'm gonna show you step by step how to carry out force resolution in space. And I can promise you it's not gonna be that bad. Okay, have a great day and weekend coming up, and I will see you guys on Monday at 11 o'clock.
Dr. Mun.
Yes, okay.
Would you recommend using like isometric graph paper to like lay out these free body diagrams?
You can, but it's not necessary because I'm gonna show you how to sketch.
Okay.
And it's not that difficult because we have the XYZ coordinates, mm-hmm. and we're just gonna use and draw right on them.
Okay.
Yeah, so you don't really need to have isometric or special paper for this. Okay. As long as you have X, Y, and Z drawn out. That's why I said in 2D, it's very helpful if you have X and Y axes. Because okay. we're just going to use them. Okay? Very good. Any other questions? Sure, Jonathan? What was homework three? Equilibrium, right? No equilibrium questions, just one and two. Yeah, just week one and two. Yeah, because when I made up the quiz, we were not quite done with equilibrium, so I didn't put anything on equilibrium. But your quiz two should start from equilibrium and then force resolution and everything else in space. Yeah. Okay, very good. Any other question I can answer for you? Okay. Anybody else? You too. Bye. Bye.